Thank you. I'm excited about hour 10 of 24 Hours of Reality and one of the most powerful reasons for hope. For billions of people around the world, faith and spirituality are a guiding force in their daily lives. We all know this, and now, more than ever before, faith communities in every single religion and denomination and their leaders are rising to meet the challenge of the climate crisis. People of all religious faiths are now calling for the care and protection of our planet, our one and only home. So I'm going to give a short presentation of what this means to me personally and what it means to faith communities from other traditions. I might say at the outset, I'm very excited that Corinna Gore, my oldest daughter, is going to be describing the Religions and Earth Conference, which has been in the works for a long time on a parallel and independent track from 24 Hours, and you'll hear about that as well. But I'm going to be presenting what some of the leaders of faith traditions have been saying about protecting the earth, protecting creation. I will have probably a few more examples from my own faith tradition, the Judeo-Christian tradition, and I hope you'll forgive me for that because I am rooted in that tradition. And I would like to begin with a moment that started in darkness. And you may remember, some of you who are as old as I am will, some of you will know it from your history books, that before the moon landing, on Christmas Eve, December 24th, 1968, before the landing of Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin the following July in 1969, Apollo 8 was the first spacecraft to go all the way to the moon and around the moon. And while they were searching for landing sites for the Apollo 11 mission the following year, they were focused on the craters on the surface of the moon and looking for good places to land. And then one of them noticed out the window this amazing picture of the Earth. And it became a very famous picture known as Earthrise. And then on Christmas Eve, the Earth heard this message. Again, it will start in darkness. This image was so powerful and had such an incredible impact on thinking all over the world that within 18 months, the first Earth Day had been organized. And in the United States and in many countries, major pieces of environmental legislation had been passed. Here in the United States, under the leadership of a Republican president, Richard Nixon, and a reminder from an earlier conversation on this stage, this used to be a bipartisan issue, and I hope, indeed I pray, that it will be again. But what we are seeing in faith communities is a recapturing and powerful re-expression of principles that every faith tradition has taught us. In the book of Genesis, we are instructed to be good stewards of the earth. And in the Torah, very similar language, not surprisingly, is expressed because it is the same passage. And in Islam, this text, the world is beautiful and verdant. Verily, God be He exalted, has made you stewards in it, and He sees how you acquit yourselves. In the Hindu faith, there are many specific instructions, including this one, do not cut the trees, because they remove pollution. in Judaism again, don't dump waste in any place from which it could be scattered by the wind or spread by flooding. Pope Francis, who I'm a Protestant, and I must say, I am so inspired by Pope Francis. I was talking earlier with Vanessa about how he has touched my heart and has touched the hearts of billions of people around the world with his genuine humility and his faithfulness. And in this very powerful expression about our responsibility to the global environment, he says, if we destroy creation, creation will destroy us. Never forget this. And how similar his teaching is to the Hindu declaration on climate change. We cannot continue to destroy nature without also destroying ourselves. These principles are indeed universal. Now, in the Vatican, the Pontifical Academy of Sciences has played a special role. Indeed, they have resolved long since some of the doctrinal disputes with science that were infamous a long time ago, even when some other faith traditions are still wrestling with them. But listen to this clear expression. The massive fossil fuel use at the heart of the global energy system deeply disrupts the Earth's climate and acidifies the world's oceans. And they go on to spotlight the impact on the world's poor, who, as they say, have a minimal role in generating global pollution, but are likely to suffer disproportionately. Pope Francis also met with the Green Patriarch of the Orthodox tradition, the Green Patriarch being Ecumenical Patriarch Bartholomew, a wonderful and wise faith leader, someone who I've had the privilege of knowing. And they put out a joint statement, Catholicism and Orthodox Christianity, jointly pledging commitment to raising awareness about the stewardship of creation and referring to this as God's world, to be cared for the benefit of God's people. In the Quran, again, we see this teaching, do not commit abuse on the earth, spreading corruption. And this from the Hadith, the second book after the Torah. The earth is green, after the Quran, the second book after the Quran. The earth is green and beautiful, and Allah has appointed you his stewards over it. And it goes on in very, very powerful language. Then in the Hindu tradition, again from the Declaration on Climate Change, the Hindu tradition understands that man is not separate from nature, that we are linked by spiritual, psychological, and physical bonds with the elements around us. Great wisdom worth remembering. Mahatma Gandhi, who said, what we are doing to the forests of the world is but a mirror reflection of what we are doing to ourselves and to one another. Many of the wisest men and women on earth have been teaching us that the climate crisis is an outward manifestation of an inner spiritual crisis. Paying attention to these principles is, I think, truly important. This again is from, this is from the Church of England, the Anglican Church, Church's scientific statement on climate, very specific. The warming of the earth is linked to CO2. The main cause is human emissions of CO2, burning fossil fuels, and deforestation. No controversy there. The Coalition on Environment and Jewish Life speaks eloquently about the need to transform the world's energy system. It's a strategy for security and survival, as well as being a religious and moral imperative. And of course, many ministers and rabbis and priests and imams go out and give of their time to teach about the imperative of stopping climate change. When we reflect on the fact that the global climate crisis is one of the principal causes of the impending extinction of up to 50% of all the living species that with whom we share this planet, we should remember the teaching in Genesis about our duty to the other creatures and life forms on this earth. Keep them alive with thee. This particular passage is one from my own tradition. It embodies the words of Jesus Christ, and I hear it in a way that strikes me very powerfully. Jesus said, he said also to the people, when ye see a cloud rise out of the west, straightway ye say, there cometh a shower. And so it is. And when ye see the south wind blow, ye say, there will be heat, and it cometh to pass. Ye hypocrites, ye can discern the face of the sky and of the earth, but how is it that ye do not discern this time? Yea, and why even of yourselves judge ye not what is right? That speaks to me so powerfully. So many religious groups have taken their commitments and their faith into the finances of their churches and synagogues and temples and denominations. All of these religious groups have now divested from fossil fuels, an inspiring example. And just as with the business community, many of them are finding that this is saving them money, especially when they devote resources to the adoption of renewable energy. The Vatican wants to be CO2 neutral. Many people are not aware that the top of the Vatican is covered with solar panels now. This church in Switzerland, similarly, this Protestant Reformed Church in Austria, this Catholic church in New Jersey, and the Episcopal Church in New Jersey. And people in faith congregations are demonstrating and are becoming active in the political system, putting their faith into action. We're seeing a lot of good works. And finally, the one teaching that I think is most commonly referred to when we think about and talk about and pray about our relationship to the environment is are these words from Psalm 24. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. The idea, by contrast, that we are unconstrained in any desire we have to aggressively exploit the earth, even at the expense of driving species into extinction, poisoning water, polluting the land, and most tragically, changing the earth's climate system in a very destructive way. That is not a way to glorify God. These acts and words by people in all the faith traditions represent to me perhaps the single most powerful reason for hope.